Yes, sir. You are.
Okay.
Sorry to intervene, sir. You can take over.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yes.
This is what I posted, and that's not what I wanted to say. This is what Bar wanted to say. I only acted as a mouthpiece of the Bar. A judge absolutely independent.
Again, there is an issue.
The audio is gone away and the video is gone.
Okay. Let's proceed with Ansin, sir.
Yes.
Sorry, I'll just take one more minute. So, in continuation of what Mr. Oza was saying, I would, from my colleagues, my friends, and from lawyers from my stature, I would term my leaderships as a most dynamic, assertive, strong, and graceful, and extremely decisive judge. We have come across fearless and, in today's perspective, a very positive judge who we would all look upon. If we have a case, we are sure to get out with some order in our hand, irrespective of the stakes involved. And unfortunately, because of this corona, dreaded corona, we could not give my leadership's fitting farewell, which we sure, I'm sure that Bar will give once things attain normalcy. So let me welcome leaderships are warmly welcomed in this webinar on this platform, and I wish my leaderships a very best future ahead.
Do we have Mr. Oza back?
No.
Okay. In that case, may I request Paresh Bhai Jani, President of the Ahmedabad Bar Association, to say a few words, please.
Very good evening to everyone. I am honored to be a panelist today in this webinar. And though I am not practicing in the High Court, I know her ladyship as she was the administrative judge of our Civil and Sessions Court of Ahmedabad, where I am practicing. She was always very much helpful in solving our court's issues, which were many, because our court's new multi-story building was almost at the stage of completion. And with her support, most of these issues which were there were solved. Whenever we requested her ladyship to give us appointment, she immediately gave the appointment as early as possible. And she also visited the under construction court building often and took the stock of the situation herself. I have found in her a noble judge, and my bar is grateful to her, Lord Ladyship, for her helping hands. I welcome Ladyship in this webinar. The lawyers will be certainly be enriched with her Lordship's suggestions and experience. Thank you very much. Welcome, Ladyship.
Thank you so much. I think there is some issue. We are unable to connect or maybe get the voice option for Mr. Oza. I think they are connected, but I don't know. Somehow there is some issue. Maybe we can start with the session and maybe get Mr. Oza to do the concluding remarks for the session.
Yes.
May I request Honorable Justice Devani to deal with today's topic, please?
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Oza, Mr. Anshin Desai, Mr. Paresh Jani, for the kind words and the good wishes. I hope I'm audible.
Yeah, audible.
As judges, we are more accustomed to listening to advocates than speaking. So this is kind of a reverse situation. My view of what judges expect from lawyers is based on my own experience as a judge of the High Court for over 15 years. I have divided this lecture into 6 topics. Pleadings, proper attire, court manners and decorum, presentation and preparation, competence, and professional ethics. The discussion on different topics may intermingle as they are connected with each other. I will start with an extract from the decision of the Supreme Court in Sudha versus Chennai Association, 2010-14 SCC 114, wherein the court held that the legal profession is a solemn and serious occupation. It is a noble calling, and all those who belong to it are its honorable members. Although the entry to the profession can be held by acquiring merely the qualification prescribed by different universities, the honor as a professional has to be maintained by its members by their exemplary conduct both in and outside the court. The legal profession is different from other professions in that what the lawyers do affects not only an individual, but the administration of justice, which is the foundation of the civilized society. Both as a leading member of the intelligentsia of the society and as an intelligent citizen, the lawyer has to conduct himself as a model for others, both in his professional and in his private and public life. This sets the tone for today's discussion. I may go to the first topic, that is pleadings. For the purpose of approaching the court for the grant of any relief, one has to file a writ petition, appeal, or other proceeding. Therefore, every court proceeding commences with pleadings. Hence, the first topic is pleadings, namely drafting petitions, memorandum of appeal, application, or affidavit in reply, etc. The first thing that is expected of an advocate is to ensure that the petition, appeal, application, etc., as the case may be, is properly drafted in accordance with the principles of law provided therefore, and in accordance with the rules prescribed in that regard. What do I mean when I say properly drafted? Firstly, the facts should be set out in a manner which gives a clear picture of the case. At times, the facts are not stated clearly, making it difficult to understand the controversy in issue. Sometimes, it is found that the facts are set out in the list of events and missing in the main petition. In writ petitions, it is the facts stated on oath by way of an affidavit that can be taken into consideration by the court. And the list of events is not a part of the affidavit and therefore cannot be taken into consideration. After stating the facts, the grounds on which the action of the respondents is assailed should be set out clearly, and an attempt should be made to cover all possible grounds. Quite often, it is found that the memorandum of petition contains sketchy grounds, and during the course of arguments, detailed submissions are made which do not find place in the petition, which is not fair to the learned advocate for the other side, as he is caught by surprise and is required to deal with the contentions that are not raised in the petition. Moreover, writ petitions are contested on the basis of affidavits, and in case a ground or a fact is not set out in the petition, it is not possible for the other side to answer the same on affidavit. Therefore, the learned advocate for the other side is constrained to seek time to deal with the facts and contentions not set out in the petition, which unnecessarily delays the matter. It is a matter of regret that these days there is a very casual approach insofar as drafting is concerned. If any lacuna is pointed out, instead of taking it positively and making amends, the advocates seem to be annoyed, and the attitude is, why so much fuss? After all, you have understood what we want to convey. Such a casual approach does not augur well for the concerned advocates, as unless there is a will to improve, there is no progress, and you stagnate where you are. This is not to say that everyone adopts a casual approach. There are some advocates whose petitions and memorandum of appeal are so well drafted that they cover every argument that they advance before the court, and every submission is put with such clarity that it makes it easy for the concerned judge to understand even a complicated case. This lessens the burden of the judge, who can take the submissions from the grounds set out in the petition while dictating the judgment. After the grounds comes the relief paragraph, or what is popularly known as the prayer clause. This is one paragraph which is required to be drafted carefully after understanding the exact nature of relief that can be granted in such a case. Many times the petition does not contain proper prayers, and the learned advocate is required to amend the prayer clause at the time of arguments, or a petition is dismissed as the necessary reliefs have not been prayed for. To be able to draft pleadings properly, it is necessary for the learned advocate to go through the case papers properly and to examine the relevant statutory provisions and decisions in that regard before dictating the matter. Otherwise, some important issue may be left out, which would later on necessitate filing of draft amendments. Last but not least, what is dictated? So when a matter is dictated, then after it has been transcribed, before the memorandum of petition is actually filed, advocate should make it a practice to read it thoroughly to ascertain whether there are any mistakes or any point has been left out. These days, the standard of drafting has deteriorated to a great extent, and the memorandum of petition or appeal, etc., contain innumerable spelling and grammatical mistakes, which can easily be obviated if the learned advocates take the trouble of going through the drafts after they are transcribed. It is quite possible that one may have dictated something by mistake, and by mistake, the stenographer may have typed something else. In case of junior advocates who are attached to someone senior to them, when the senior gives some dictation, they should make it a practice to read the pleadings after they are transcribed. And in case they notice any mistakes, bring it to the notice of their senior. Apart from the mistakes being corrected, this serves two purposes. Firstly, you get an opportunity to read the case and therefore are able to understand the issues involved and can follow the case when the senior conducts the matter before the court. And you would also be in a position to assist him by finding the relevant precedents. Secondly, you get a good grip over how to draft a petition or application and the legal terms that are generally used while drafting. While drafting, use only those words of which you know the meaning. Advocates have a propensity of borrowing language used by others without first understanding the meaning of such word, and at times end up conveying just the opposite of what they want to convey. Also, avoid using abbreviations. I remember in law college, we had a very reputed professor, Mr. Umakant Pandit, who taught us that we should always use the full forms of the words in the pleadings. However, these days there is a tendency to resort to abbreviations without referring to the long form even once. At times when the learned advocate is called upon to explain the abbreviation, he is at a loss and is not able to answer. Another thing is that the advocate should exercise restraint in the language that they employ while drafting and should not get carried away by emotions and sentiments. Sometimes the language used in the pleadings borders on the contumacious and can get the concerned advocate into trouble, as the advocate who drafted the petition is equally responsible as the maker of the affidavit if the contents thereof are offensive. A piece of advice for junior advocates: if you come across a new word, look into the dictionary and find out the exact meaning and don't go by impressions. People have a habit of going by impressions regarding the meaning of a word, which sometimes results in conveying the wrong meaning. Certain provisions of law require the memorandum to be drafted as prescribed therein. In appeals from original decrees, namely first appeals under section 96 of the Code of Civil Procedure, subrule 2 of rule 1 of order 41 provides that the memorandum shall set forth concisely and under distinct heads the grounds or objection to the decree appealed from, without any argument or narrative, and such grounds shall be numbered consecutively. Rule 2 of order 41 of the code provides that the appellant shall not, except by leave of the court, urge or be heard in support of any ground or objection not set forth in the memorandum of appeal, but the appellate court, in deciding the appeal, shall not be confined to the grounds or objections set forth in the memorandum of appeal or taken by leave of the court under this rule. Therefore, an advocate cannot urge any ground unless he has set it out in the memorandum of appeal. However, in actual practice, it is found that compliance of the above rules is more an exception than the rule. It appears that the learned advocates are not aware of such rule, and more often than not, the memorandum of appeal is drafted as if it were an empty formality, where the grounds are set out without reference to the actual controversy. If the court were to insist on strict compliance with the above rules, the learned advocates would not be in a position to make any submissions, inasmuch as it appears that the memorandum of appeals are drafted hurriedly, without proper application of mind, only with a view to save limitation and ensure that there is no delay. Such a practice is not a healthy practice. Assuming that the memorandum could not be drafted as the bar of limitation was fast approaching, it is always possible to file further proper grounds by way of an amendment. However, hardly anyone bothers to undertake the trouble. In second appeals under section 100 of the Code of Civil Procedure, as well as in tax appeals before the High Court, an appeal can be preferred only if the case involves a substantial question of law. Therefore, the question of law has to be framed to bring out the exact controversy, and it should not be argumentative. More often than not, in tax appeals, it is found that the questions proposed by the learned advocates are argumentative, and if accepted as they are, there would be nothing left for the court to decide. Therefore, one has to study the case properly before drafting the memorandum of appeal and propose the questions of law after due application of mind. One important aspect from a judge's point of view is that the pleading should also be legible. By legible, I don't mean only clear, but also of a size that can be read with ease. Therefore, don't just leave it to the discretion of the stenographer to adopt any font that he wants. The fonts used should be big enough to read with ease. Size 13 or 14 would be appropriate. Sometimes the fonts are so small that the concerned judge has to strain his eyes to read them and has to make tremendous efforts to read the matter. Remember that majority of judges in the High Court are above 50 years of age. So the least you can ensure is that the petitions or memorandum of appeal are clearly legible. At the same time, very large fonts should also be avoided. The next topic is proper attire. Advocates are expected to be appropriately attired in the prescribed uniform and be presentable when they appear before the court. You should at all times be dressed in proper attire as prescribed for advocates by the relevant rules, and your appearance should be presentable and not disheveled or shabby. At times, we come across advocates wearing soiled bands and unkempt hair, which creates a very poor impression in the mind of the learned judge. While addressing the court, your coat should be buttoned up. This is not something which should be required to be said, but unfortunately, this has now become more of an exception than the rule. Remember that the legal profession is a very dignified profession, and therefore, you must dress in a dignified manner when you appear before the court. I recently came across a well-written article by the learned Solicitor General, Mr. Tushar Mehta, in Bar and Bench, where he has aptly stated that a uniform is to make a designated group of people dignified and, more importantly, impersonal, to give it the singleness and tautness of upstanding men of character. It acts as an equalizer. Once in uniform, rich and poor, successful or beginners, every lawyer is on the same visual pedestal. Coming to the next topic, that is court manners. At the outset, I would like to refer to an extract from Varwell's Legal Ethics as extracted by the Supreme Court in Mahabir Prasad Singh versus Jack's Aviation Private Limited, 1999-1 SEC 37. A lawyer is under an obligation to do nothing that shall detract from the dignity of the court, of which he is himself a sworn officer and assistant. He should at all times pay deferential respect to the judge and scrupulously observe the decorum of the courtroom. By court manners, I mean the manner in which the advocate conducts himself in the courtroom. A judge first and foremost expects the advocates to maintain the dignity and decorum of the courtroom and their profession and to avoid disorder and disruption. While it is true that the court process is adversarial in nature, advocates should behave in a civil manner with all parties, witnesses and other counsel. In the High Court, the court proceedings normally commence with what is called mentioning. While mentioning, an advocate should use the proper form of address and refer to his or her senior or colleagues as Mr., Miss, or Mrs. So-and-so. Even when an advocate refers to his friend, he should prefix his name with a Mr., Miss, Mrs. or Miss as the case may be. One should not adopt a casual approach in the courtroom. An advocate should refrain from using advocates' abbreviations like AG, AAG, ASG, and GP while referring to the learned advocate general, the learned additional advocate general, the learned assistant solicitor general, and the learned government pleader, as well as short forms of months like Jan, Feb, etc. One should also not use slang while arguing a case. What is considered cool outside the courtroom is not cool inside the courtroom. Remember that the courtroom is a place where an advocate has to behave in a dignified manner, and using short forms or slang is certainly not dignified. While you should be clearly audible when you make submissions, don't shout. At times, advocates behave as if the judge is the opponent. Beginners should make it a practice to sit in the courtroom and watch the proceedings and learn how the seniors address the court and learn proper court manners from them. Equally, it is the duty of the seniors to groom the junior advocates and correct them if necessary. While conducting a case, refer to your colleagues in a respectful manner and always maintain the decorum of the court. Don't bicker in the courtroom by saying, my learned friend may not say this, or that my learned friend has not furnished some document or application to me just request him or her. The learned advocates are grown-up men and women and should be in a position to deal with such things on their own. And it is not the place of the learned judge to monitor the behavior of the learned advocates and admonish them as if he is their parents. Senior advocates should set a good example for the juniors to follow, as the juniors are likely to emulate them. Advocates who do not appear regularly in the High Court should acquaint themselves with the procedure and the manner of conducting matters before the High Court, and vice versa. Advocates should be adequately prepared to address the matters they have before the court in an efficient and timely manner. In Chetak Construction Limited versus Om Prakash, 1998, 4 SCC 577, the Supreme Court observed as under, indeed, no lawyer or litigant can be permitted to browbeat the court or malign the presiding officer with a view to get a favorable order. Judges shall not be able to perform their duties freely and fairly if such activities were permitted. And in the result, administration of justice would become a casualty and the rule of law would receive a setback. The judges are obliged to decide cases impartially and without any fear or favor. Lawyers and litigants cannot be allowed to terrorize or intimidate judges with a view to secure orders which they want. This is basic and fundamental, and no civilized system of administration of justice can permit it. Address the court respectfully and don't try to browbeat or overawe the judge. It does not matter how you address the court, whether you address the judge as your lordship, your honor, or a plain and simple sir or madam. Don't deride the judge in the open court merely to impress your clients that you can get away with anything. In a division bench, treat both the judges equally. The less senior judge is also entitled to be given the same respect and treatment and should not be ignored when you address the court. In O.P. Sharma versus High Court of Punjab and Haryana, 2011, 6 SCC 86, the Supreme Court held that advocacy touches and asserts the primary value of freedom of expression. It is a practical manifestation of the principle of freedom of speech. Freedom of expression in arguments encourages the development of judicial dignity, forensic skills of advocacy, and enables protection of fraternity, equality, and justice. It plays its part in helping to secure the protection of other fundamental human rights. Freedom of expression, therefore, is one of the basic conditions for the progress of advocacy and for development of every man, including legal fraternity, practicing the profession of law. Freedom of expression, therefore, is vital to the maintenance of free society. It is essential to the rule of law and liberty of citizens. The advocate or the party appearing in person, therefore, is given liberty of expression, but they equally owe countervailing duty to maintain dignity, decorum, and order in the court proceedings or judicial process. Any adverse opinion about the judiciary should only be expressed in a detached manner and respectful language. The liberty of free expression is not to be confounded or confused with license to make unfounded allegations against any institution, much less the judiciary. Lastly, with some reluctance, I may add that advocates are expected to adhere to basic etiquette, like not yawning, belching, burping loudly, and in an uncouth manner. It is thoroughly disgusting when an advocate picks his nose in the courtroom. These are not things which should be required to be taught. But imagine my plight when an advocate first picked his nose and then with the same hand tendered a document across the bar. Advocates who appear in a matter should be competent to handle the matter. Sorry, the next topic of discussion is competence. Advocates who appear in a matter should be competent to handle the matter before the court. The level of competence of different advocates would vary. Not all advocates can possess the same level of competence, nor are they expected to. But when you take up a brief, you owe a duty to your client to do justice to his case. Therefore, even if you are not well conversant with the law, before you start arguing the case, you should study the relevant provisions properly. At times, advocates take up a brief on a subject of which they hardly have any knowledge and do not bother to look into the legal provisions and the settled position of law on the subject. As a consequence thereof, they are not able to put up the case properly, nor are they in a position to assist the court in a proper manner, which results in a waste of judicial hours and throws the entire burden on the learned judge who has to study the case on his own and decide the same so as to ensure that the litigant does not suffer on account of the incompetence of his advocate. An advocate should learn the language of the court. For example, English is the language used in the High Court. Therefore, unless an advocate is well versed with the language, he will not be able to put forth the case properly. Therefore, advocates should attempt to widen their vocabulary in the language of the court before they come, before which they are regularly practicing. One can understand that a newcomer who is not well versed with the language and may not be able to express himself properly initially. But if he wants to practice in the High Court, he has to learn to master the language. If he wants to be successful in the field, it is quite unfortunate that some advocates do not make any attempt to learn even simple English, though they practice in the High Court regularly. And they find it difficult to speak even two sentences in English properly. Preparation and presentation is the next and the main topic. The learned advocate should be thoroughly prepared with the case and should come to the court even at the stage of the first hearing of the case with the relevant decisions on which they ultimately seek to place reliance. They should be able to present the case clearly and concisely without wasting the time of the court and should be clear in their submissions. When a query is put to you, answer it and don't prevaricate. Unless you clear the doubts in the mind of the learned judge, he will not be able to appreciate your case properly. On many occasions, when a query on a question of law is put to the learned advocate, he requests for time to find out a judgment in his favor. Such a practice should be avoided. And at the time when he prepares the case, the learned advocate should examine the case from all angles and be prepared to answer the query raised by the court, including citations in his favor. Of course, once in a while, one may not anticipate a query and may need to ask for an adjournment. However, in respect of simple queries which arise out of the matter, one should not be seeking an adjournment. All instructions should be taken before arguing the matter, except in an exceptional case, when a totally unanticipated query on facts is raised, or you want to consult your client as to whether he wants to withdraw the case, you should not take instructions from your client in the courtroom. This applies with greater force to assistant government pleaders, who more often than not are found to be taking instructions in the courtroom. Whenever the court puts a query, he or she turns to the briefing officer to take instructions, which clearly shows that he or she is not properly prepared to conduct the case. All instructions should be taken on the previous day or in the morning before court hours. Advocate should remember that the client comes to him with the facts and it is for them to examine the legal position and advise them accordingly. It is the advocate who has to brief the client about the legal position and not the other way around. Nonetheless, we come across cases where the advocates even expect the client to brief them about the legal position. For junior advocates, when you come to mention in a court for an adjournment or for any other reason, glance through the case papers and get an idea of what the case is about and also ascertain the reason why you're seeking an adjournment or mentioning the matter so that you don't have to face an embarrassment if the court puts any queries. Equally, the senior should permit the junior to go through the case papers before asking him to mention before the court. It is not fair on the part of the senior to send the junior to make a mention before the court without properly acquainting him with the facts and putting him in an embarrassing position of not being able to answer the query put by the court. I had the opportunity to assist former Advocate General late Sri J.M. Thakur, who once told me that his senior told him that he should prepare every matter as if he is required to conduct it himself. Therefore, merely because a senior advocate is appearing in the matter, the advocate and record should not feel that he is not required to be prepared. He too should be thoroughly prepared for an eventuality where the learned senior advocate is not in a position to attend the case and the court is not willing to grant an adjournment. Proper assistance means that the concerned advocate should be thoroughly prepared with the matter and should be in a position to answer every query raised by the court. More often than not, advocates avoid answering queries raised by the court, which is not a good sign as it shows lack of preparedness. Advocates also should learn to listen so that they understand the query asked by the court. Every query does not mean that the court is against you on an issue. At times you may not have studied the case from a particular angle, which is more favorable to your case, and the learned judge is merely trying to bring it to your notice. Be clear and precise in your arguments and don't unnecessarily waste the time of the court by being repetitive. Be ready with the citations on which you seek to place reliance. It is highly annoying when the learned advocate keeps the court waiting while he whiles away time looking for the precedent which he wants to cite, resulting in loss of precious time. You are all aware that courts are overburdened with dockets. When you unnecessarily waste time, the proceedings get prolonged unnecessarily. More often than not, many other advocates are waiting for the matter to be taken up. And when one advocate wastes time unnecessarily, he causes inconvenience to all his colleagues who have to wait longer. You should also learn to maintain deadlines. If you have asked for an adjournment to file an affidavit in reply or an affidavit in rejoinder, you should ensure that it is ready by the next date. Don't keep asking for adjournments on the same ground again and again, as it not only unnecessarily delays the hearing of the case, but also shows you in a poor light, and the learned judge carries an impression that you are never ready with the matter. When you cite a decision before the court, understand the difference between a judgment simpliciter and a decision which lays down some principle of law, and find out the ratio decidency of that decision. In Lakshmi Devi versus State of Bihar, 2015-10 SEC 241, the Supreme Court held that the term ratio decidendi is a Latin term which means the decision, the reason for deciding in a judgment, the enunciation of the reason or principle upon which a question before a court has been decided is alone binding as a precedent. The ratio decidendi is the underlying principle, namely the general reasons or the general grounds upon the decision, upon which the decision is based, on the test or abstract from specific peculiarities of a particular case which gives rise to the decision. The ratio decidendi of a judgment is its reasoning, which can be deciphered only upon reading the same in its entirety. The ratio decidendi of a case are the principles and reasons on which it is based is distinct from the final relief granted or the manner adopted for its disposal. Thus, judgment is a precedent. Thus, a judgment is a precedent for the principle of law that it lays down. Therefore, not every judgment is a precedent. These days, it is common practice to show an order passed by a coordinate bench which may not contain any discussion of law and cite it as a precedent, saying that on similar facts, the court has decided in a particular manner without showing the principle laid down therein. Therefore, it is important to read a judgment thoroughly to understand its precedential value. Just referring to headnotes is not a healthy practice, as headnotes can often be misleading and you may not find what is stated in the headnotes in the body of the judgment. Also, please don't cite overruled judgments. It is not fair to the court and also amounts to misconduct.
Ma'am, may I just interrupt you? Tomorrow yes. Video kadach band thai gayo lage. We can't see you on this. Yeah, that's fine. Thank you. Sorry for the inconvenience. Okay, all right.
These days, with the advent of technology, as judgments are easily available, it has become a practice to cite a plethora of judgments, both relevant and irrelevant, leaving it to the concerned judge to wade through them and deal with each one of them. It is the duty of the concerned advocate to read each of the judgments cited by him and find out the most relevant and apposite ones and cite only such judgments. A little effort on the part of the learned advocates would save a lot of time and energy on the part of the concerned judge. Another thing is that some advocates think they are more entitled than others and expect to be given an audience out of turn. While it is true that the waiting period in the courtroom is quite tedious, it applies to all advocates, so one has to wait for one's turn. Advocates who come from outside the city or the state are not entitled to any special treatment or priority in audience simply because they come from some other state and it is not convenient for them to come on the next date, as it would be unfair on the part of the local advocates and would create an impression that if a counsel from an outside state is engaged, the chances of the matter being taken up for hearing are more. Withdrawing of cases with a view to make a representation is a widespread malaise. When an advocate withdraws a case with a view to make a representation before an authority, he is being unfair to his client and merely giving rise to another round of litigation. In writ petitions, in most cases, it is orders of statutory authorities which are subject matter of challenge. These authorities have no power to entertain a representation against an order passed by them, as they have no power to review or revise their orders. And it is only the higher forum which can set aside the order passed by such authority. Therefore, making a representation is of no avail, as the authority concerned would not be in a position to vary the earlier order passed by him, and the fate of the representation is a foregone conclusion. Therefore, giving hope to the client is not fair to him. Once you take up a brief, take it to its logical conclusion. If there is an adverse order, it can always be challenged. Don't take the easy route of withdrawing with a view to make a representation. While conducting criminal appeals, it is expected that the advocates go through the entire evidence before commencement of the hearing and are able to correlate the testimonies of the witnesses and point out any inconsistencies therein. However, more often than not, it appears that the learned advocates read the evidence for the first time in the courtroom after commencement of the hearing of the case. The evidence has to be read closely to be able to impeach the credibility of a witness or support the credibility of a witness. For this purpose, the cross-examination of the witness is very important, and the learned advocate should go through the evidence thoroughly to ascertain as to which part of the testimony of the witness can actually be relied upon, instead of leaving it to the court to conduct such exercise. Like Mr. Jayalunwala said in his lecture a few days back, read the evidence of each witness lest you lose out on some important evidence. Do not miss out on any part of the cross-examination. You should also be well-versed with the basic provisions of the Criminal Procedure Code 1973 and the Evidence Act, like the scope of sections 162 and 162 of the code, as well as the provisions of section 145 to 158 of the Evidence Act. It is only if you are aware of the scope of these provisions that you will be in a proper position to appreciate the evidence. Quite often questions are asked in cross-examination which are not otherwise permissible in law. But because of lack of knowledge of these provisions, the concerned advocate is not aware that such part of the cross-examination would not be admissible in evidence. Moreover, the testimony of each witness should be examined in the context of the testimony of the investigating officer to ascertain as to whether any contradiction in the statement of the witness before the court and before the police has been brought on record and proved. Therefore, the credibility of a witness can be supported or impeached not by merely referring to the inconsistencies in the testimonies of the witnesses, but also by referring to the part of the evidence which is not admissible as being hit by the bar contained in section 162 of the code. However, by and large, the advocates never advert to these provisions or the inadmissibility of evidence. To understand the scope and purport of the provisions of section 162 of the Code of Criminal Procedure and section 145 and other provisions of the Evidence Act, one should read the landmark decision of the Supreme Court in Tehsildar Singh versus State of UP, AIR 1959 SC 1012, which still holds the field. It is expected that the learned advocates read the leading decisions on questions of law and issues which are involved in each case thoroughly, so that they are able to assist the court properly. Another disheartening practice which is developing these days is arguing final hearing matters like admission cases by simply going to the issue involved without adverting to the facts and the evidence, leaving it to the learned judge to read everything and decide on his own. One classic example of abdication of duty towards the client is by using the oft-stated words, lordships may pass appropriate orders. In other words, the learned advocate refrains from arguing the case and saves himself the trouble of studying the case, leaving it to the learned judge to read the papers on his own and decide the case as he or she pleases. Sometimes matters which are similar in nature are clubbed together for hearing and are commonly known as group matters. In such cases, the learned advocates argue one case and say that the rest of the matters are identical. However, at times later on, it is found that the issues involved in some of the matters are not the same. Therefore, while arguing a group of cases, it is expected that the learned advocate goes through each case to ascertain whether they are in fact identical. When an advocate makes a statement before the court that all the matters are identical, the court is likely to believe him. Therefore, any statement made before the court should be made with responsibility after ascertaining correct facts. In HP Scheduled Tribes Employees Federation versus HP Samanya Varg Karmchari Kalyan Mahasangh 2013-10 SEC 308, the Supreme Court held that when a statement is made before the court, it is, as a matter of course, assumed that it is made sincerely and is not an effort to overreach the court. Numerous matters, even involving momentous questions of law, are often disposed of by the court on the basis of the statement made by the learned counsel for the parties. The statement is accepted as it is assumed without doubt to be honest sincere, truthful, solemn, and in the interest of justice. The statement by the counsel is not expected to be flippant, mischievous, misleading, and certainly not false. This confidence in the statements made by the learned counsel is founded on the assumption that the counsel is aware that he is an officer of the court. Another thing which at times is very difficult to tolerate is when an advocate asks for an adjournment in a fresh matter on the ground that he is not prepared with the matter. What is lost sight of while making such a request is that the learned judge has spent considerable time studying the case, and when an adjournment is sought for, it results in a waste of all the effort, and by the time the matter comes up for hearing again, it is not possible to remember the facts and the issue involved, and the entire exercise is required to be carried out again. An important habit that is required to be adopted is punctuality. Advocates should be punctual and should try to present their case when called out. Many a times, the learned advocate whose matter is listed at serial number 1 on the board is not present when the matter is called out, as a consequence whereof he has to wait till his turn comes after the board is exhausted. The next topic is professional ethics, where I would refer more to the principles laid down by the Supreme Court in this regard. Advocates are expected to maintain a high standard of ethics. While an advocate owes a duty to his client to represent his case in the best manner possible, to the best of his ability, that is where his duty ends. He does not owe any duty to his client to win the case by adopting underhand means like misleading the court, etc. Filing appearance in a matter at the instance of a litigant only to ensure that a particular judge recuses from the matter is rampant these days and is a conduct which needs to be highly deprecated. Abuse of the process of court in any matter should not be resorted to. Advocates are also expected to protect the judiciary from baseless, scurrilous attacks. In A, an advocate in re, AR 1962 Supreme Court 1337, the Supreme Court commented that a lawyer must never be a liar. In Jaipur Vikas Pradhikaran versus Ashok Kumar Chaudhary 2011, 14 SSC 105, the Supreme Court held that a counsel's paramount duty is to the client, and accordingly, where he forms an opinion that a conflict of interest exists, his duty is to advise the client that he should engage some other lawyer. It was further held that it is unprofessional to represent conflicting interests except by express consent given by all concerned after a full disclosure of the facts. The court further went on to hold that the relation between the lawyer and his client is highly fiduciary in nature and of a very delicate, exacting, and confidential character, requiring a high degree of fidelity and good faith, and it is purely a personal relationship involving the highest personal trust and confidence, which cannot be delegated without consent. The court also held that when a lawyer is entrusted with a brief, he is expected to follow the norms of professional ethics and try to protect the interests of his clients in relation to whom he occupies a position of trust. In P.D. Khandekar versus Bar Council of Maharashtra, 1984 2 SCC 556, the Supreme Court held that for an advocate to act towards his client otherwise than with utmost good faith is unprofessional. When an advocate is entrusted with a brief, he is expected to follow norms of professional ethics and try to protect the interests of his client in relation to whom he occupies a position of trust. Counsel's paramount duty is to the client. When a person consults a lawyer for his advice, he relies upon his requisite experience, skill, and knowledge as a lawyer. And the lawyer is expected to give proper and dispassionate legal advice to the client for the protection of his interests. An advocate stands in a loco parentis towards the litigants, and it therefore follows that the client is entitled to receive disinterested, sincere, and honest treatment, especially when the client approaches the advocate for succor in times of need. The members of the legal profession should stand free from suspicion. Nothing should be done by any member of the legal fraternity which might tend to lessen in any degree the confidence of the public in the fidelity, honesty, and integrity of the profession. For an advocate to act towards his client otherwise than with utmost good faith is unprofessional. It is against professional etiquette for a lawyer to give improper legal advice for an ulterior object. It is unworthy of an advocate to accept it is unworthy that an advocate should accept employment with such motive or so long as his client has such understanding of his purpose. it is professionally improper for a bar member of the bar to prepare false documents or draw pleadings knowingly that the allegations made are untrue to his knowledge. Thus, the giving of improper legal advice may amount to professional misconduct. That, however, may not be so by giving the wrong legal advice. In O.P. Sharma versus High Court of Punjab and Haryana, 2011, 6 SCC 86, the Supreme Court held that an advocate's duty is as important as that of a judge. Advocates have a large responsibility towards the society. A client's relationship with his/her advocate is underlined by utmost trust. An advocate is expected to act with utmost sincerity and respect. In all professional functions, an advocate should be diligent, and his conduct should also be diligent and should conform to the requirements of the law, by which an advocate plays a vital role in the preservation of society and justice system. An advocate is under an obligation to uphold the rule of law and ensure that the public justice system is enabled to function at its full potential. Any violation of the principles of professional ethics by an advocate is unfortunate and unacceptable. Ignoring even a minor violation, misconduct militates against the fundamental foundation of the public justice system. An advocate should be dignified in his dealings to the court, to his fellow lawyers, and to litigants. He should have integrity in abundance and should never do anything that erodes his credibility. An advocate has a duty to enlighten and encourage the juniors in the profession. An ideal advocate should believe that the legal profession has an element of service also, and associates with legal service activities. Most importantly, he should faithfully abide by the standards of professional conduct and etiquette prescribed by the Bar Council of India in Chapter 2, Part 6 of the Bar Council of India rules. As a rule, an advocate, being a member of the legal profession, has a social duty to show the people a beacon of light by his conduct and actions, rather than being adamant on an unwarranted and uncalled for issue. In Yatin Narendra Oza versus Khemchand Rajaram Koshti, 2016-15 SCC 236, the Supreme Court emphasized the necessity of dignified behavior, obedience to the norms of professional ethics, and sustenance of decorum of the institution to stabilize the nobility of the profession and to ensure the faith in the justice delivery system, which is extremely dear to a civilized society. These are the high standards of ethics expected from an advocate as depicted by the Supreme Court, and this is what the judiciary expects from the advocates. I conclude by expressing my gratitude to the various tax associations and Mr. Parth Contractor for giving me this opportunity of expressing my views. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am, for these wonderful views. In fact, it is an eye-opener not only for people who've been practicing the legal profession for years, but even for the newcomers. It's definitely a learning experience. Thank you so much for sparing time for all of us. On behalf of the tax associations, there is one special request to thank you, because you've been part of a large number of tax jurisprudence which lawyers and departments either ways rely upon day in, day out. So that was one sense of thank you to you. We would now invite Mr. Oza, President of the Gujarat High Court Advocates Association, to put in his introductory as well as concluding remarks. Sorry, sir, there was some technical issue because of which we could not have the introductory from you.
Anyway, introduction comes first. It is over, but two things I want to say for juniors who are listening to this, and which is very important for them to learn, is that you can begin at any age. And that's what exactly Madam Justice Devani did. She started her practice almost on completion of 34 years of her life. She practiced as lawyer only for 12 years. Possibly very, very few cases where person has spent more years as a judge of the High Court than what he or she has practiced at the bar. You may find number of cases where at the age of 28, 30, one gets into judicial service, subordinate judicial service, and then rise like Justice Palekar at the age of 29, He became civil judge junior division, come JMFC, and became a Supreme Court judge. But practice only in the High Court and then reach at such a stage in such a short span of practice, I think barring Justice Bose of Calcutta High Court, nobody else in the country has been offered elevation as a judge of the High Court with less than 12 years of practice. Of course, when she was administered oath as a judge of the High Court, she had 12 years and 3 months of practice, July 92, if I am not mistaken. But when she was offered High Court judgeship by the then Chief Justice Bhavani Singh, her standing at the bar was 11 years and 6 months or something little more than that. Not only that what she spoke, she meant, but she implemented. And that is the reason why only 11 and a half years at the bar, in recognition of her merits, that she was requested to join the judiciary. Nobody else, excepting Justice Bose, who was offered High Court judgeship on completion of 11 years and became a judge of the High Court at the age of 34, 35, with 12 years of practice, ever one has got this distinction. I have faced her as a lawyer, very, very tough opponent. Everything that she spoke and what she expects from a lawyer, I have seen in her actually being followed and implemented. And that is why today that she has enlightened us and has really, like a teacher taught to many juniors who are joined, who are in this program and who has joined this program. For them, it's a lifetime lesson. I have seen her in the toughest time when the court was against her. I don't know whether Madam Justice recollects or not, whether on a particular entry, a land can be termed as new tenure or old tenure. And toughest judges like Justice Kalla and Justice Tripathi, completely against her. She argued the matter for a day and a half and without repetition. That's very important. Anyway, rest, all of us know. And I was reading when I got disconnected, when the day she demitted the office, I had expressed the feeling for and on behalf of the bar. Though the language was mine, feeling was unanimous. A judge absolutely independent, who never succumbed to any pressure in any form and always did boldly and courageously what she felt was right. A judge of impeccable integrity and honesty. Her retirement is a great loss to the institution, but inevitable. Thank you, madam. Thank you for enlightening more particularly junior members of the bar. And I hope and trust all members of the bar who are listening to this program will religiously follow the teachings and preachings that Madam Justice Devani has given through her lecture today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Oza, for these remarks and concluding remarks. Thank you, all the dignitaries, the president of the AGFTC, the president of the Income Tax Bar Association, Shri Paresh Bhai Jani, Shri Anshin Bhai Desai, Shri Anil Bhai Shah, Shri Dhiresh Bhai Shah, Vishvesh Bhai, Kartike Bhai, and Asutosh Bhai, and all other participants. Thank you so much for being a part of the webinar today. We will see all of you day after tomorrow at 4 p.m. We have a very interesting topic by Mr. Shalin Mehta, which is freedom of speech versus defamation, and it assumes even more significance given the last week's events that have happened vis-a-vis the freedom of the press. So we hope Mr. Mehta will be throwing some light on that issue as well. Thank you all. A big thank you once again to Honorable Justice Devani for sparing time for us. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.